This is just an image to begin of walking out of Herat at the end of 2001. The Arab geographer Ibn Halkul says in the 10th century that for the first 6.5 days walk east of Herat, the ground is flat until you reach the hill country of Gor. And indeed, this is correct. The ground is very flat. There you can see some sheep, a good indication because it indicates there's probably not a minefield in that place, and a shepherd with his sheepdog. This is my friend Aziz when the snow had fallen. And here, of course, we talk a lot about economic development. We talk about Ricardo, comparative or competitive advantage. Here we have Afghanistan's comparative advantage. It is the only country in the world which is able to produce 92% of the world's heroin and still receive $4 billion a year in international aid. And this is the heroin on its way to the market. The donkeys have had their noses slightly cut open because they're traveling at high altitude over 15,000 foot passes, and the traders believe this helps them to breathe at high altitude. This is a friend of mine called Abdul Haq, perhaps an interesting example of the lives of people in central Afghanistan. He joined the jihad, the resistance against the Russians, at the age of 12, initially as a cook boy, and at the age of 15 was given this weapon, his favorite possession, which he cuddles at night. He cuddles it at night for comfort. He uses it as an improvised pole vaulting stick as he walks along. He uses it to fire at doves and pigeons and to threaten small children. At the age of 18, he went to Iran where he worked in a truck stop selling matches in order to raise the money for the bride price. Afghanistan is a culture in which getting married involves the man's family giving the woman's family, currently in Afghanistan, between $4,000 and $5,000 generally for a family such as Abdul Haq's. And of course, the wage rates in Afghanistan is very low. So to earn this kind of money, Abdul Haq had to work in Iran. And indeed, there have been nearly 5 million Afghan refugees out of a population of about 26 million in either Iran or Pakistan, partly driven there by war, but partly also, like Abdul Haq, for economic reasons. He then came back the day before I met him. He'd killed 17 Taliban in a single day. He's quite a difficult man to communicate with because he was in the habit of firing his weapon without any ear protection. So it was a bit like talking to my 85-year-old father. He was quite deaf, had to bellow at him. But generous, kind, sometime a little bit unpredictable, slightly fiery temper, but a good companion. And here indeed, as Ibn Halkul says, 6.5 days into your journey, you come across the first hill across your route, the hill country of Gor. And there on the top of the hill is this dome. This dome was built in the 12th century, in the 1180s. And it was built by a very mysterious dynasty, the dynasty of the Turquoise Mountain, the Ghurid dynasty, a central highland dynasty that for a very, very short period controlled an empire that stretched from Delhi to Baghdad. And buried underneath this dome is a member of the Chistia order of dervishes, a Sufi, a Muslim missionary who carried Islam into India in the 12th century. You can see it's been struck by a Russian tank shell in the top right. This is a picture of me looking a little bit perplexed, a little bit frightened. The reason I'm looking a bit frightened is that the man immediately on my right, Mullah Mustafa, in the dove gray turban, had just tried to shoot me. That's Nadir Shah sitting on his right, who's his first cousin. I'd taken refuge in this house, and I was a little bit disturbed when a little bit later Mullah Mustafa turned up with his gunmen around him. He travels with about 30 to 40 men, generally walking in a crocodile line behind him in assortments of strange headgear. The men you can see there in the picture, mostly in turbans, but he also has men who wear Russian tank commanders' caps, strange chitrali caps, Sindhi jeweled caps. So I was a bit concerned when, having shot at me, he turned up in the place where I was taking refuge and then wanted to have his photograph taken with me. I was too frightened on this occasion to ask him why he was trying to shoot me, but I saw him again 18 months later, and I said, Mullah Mustafa, why were you trying to shoot me? And he said that Nadir Shah, on his right, had bet him that he couldn't hit me. This is my friend Dr. Habibullah Sharwal, the local village veterinarian. And this is the village from which he comes. It's called Dahane Razak. It's a village of about 8 houses, 3 hours walk from the next village. It's a place where everybody is descended from a single great-grandfather. And here, about a day and a half's walk further into the journey, standing by the pillar, clutching my walking stick, is a man called Haji Mualim Mohsen Khan Kamenji. This is actually not a series of names, but a series of titles, meaning pilgrim to Mecca, hereditary chief of the Taimani Aimak, teacher, landlord of Kamenj. He's a very interesting example of power structures in central Afghanistan. He was an official under the king in 1972. When the king was then toppled by his cousin in a coup d'etat in 1973, he became an official under the king's cousin. When the king's cousin was shot in the presidential palace in 1978, in a leftist revolution, he became an official under the leftist government. He then became an official under the Russian government. He then became a commander in the resistance to the Russians in 1986. He then became a Taliban commander. And then, at the period where I met him, he was in hiding. He just tried to shoot Ismail Khan, who was then the governor of Herat. But he's now back in again as the education director of the local city of Shahrak. So a very interesting example of power structures in central Afghanistan. Elections have happened, constitutions have changed, but Haji Mualim Khan remains in place. And here in a very narrow, deserted gorge in the center of Afghanistan, walking with my dog, we see a tower. And as we come to the base of the tower, this is what it's revealed to be. The base of the tower, you can see a horse for scale. The tower is nearly 180 feet high. It is again built in the 12th century by this very mysterious dynasty, the dynasty of the Turquoise Mountain, first seen by a foreign archaeologist in 1957, though, of course, the community who lived near the tower would have been aware of its existence over the previous 800 years. In turquoise blue tiles around the neck is written, Sultan Ghiyasuddin Ghori Ibn Sam, King of Kings. And around the column, you can see geometrical shapes which, in fact, spell out the Maryam Surah of the Quran. This is the surah about Mary, the mother of Jesus. And at the base of the column were found Hebrew tombstones. All of this, the signs of an extremely cosmopolitan, sophisticated religion, which encompassed Hindu communities, Zoroastrian communities, Buddhist communities, Jewish communities, although it was predominantly an Islamic community at this period in the 12th century. I climbed up to the top of the tower and was surprised to see these people. Surprised for a couple of reasons. Firstly, this is a very barren, deserted gorge, which is why the goat is traveling in the saddlebag of the cow, because it's too hungry to be able to walk. But secondly, because people really don't live close to this area. Why were they there? They were there because they were digging into the hillside. They had dragged out of the ground carved wooden doors, ivory chess pieces, fragments of Chinese porcelain imported down the Silk Road 800 years earlier, fragments of rose pink Chinese porcelain. All these objects, evidence that they had uncovered a lost city, the city of the Turquoise Mountain, destroyed by Chinggis Khan in the 12th century, or the early 13th century, and then lost to history. The villagers were selling the objects for about a dollar a time to traders, whence they find their way into shops in New York, in Paris, in London, in Tokyo. I just met a man in Kuwait who'd bought some objects, two gold tubes, which say Sultan Ghiyasuddin Ghori Ibn Sam on them. He'd bought them for $135,000. My friend Commandant Bushir had sold them for about $10 when he'd found them on this site.